Well, thank you for joining us, Beckie. Would you mind just introducing yourself and what you do?
Sure. So I'm Beckie Gierer, and I work at the Missouri Department of Mental Health. I'm the Director of Continuity of Operation Planning for the department, and I work in the Office of Disaster Services. I am also a contracted trainer with the Substance Abuse Mental Health Services Administration, also known as SAMHSA. It's a mouthful. And what that means is I go out and train around the country after federally declared disaster events. And a fun fact, since this is a church interview, I am a member of JCFUMC and have been for 46 years.
Wow. So you grew up in the church?
I did.
Okay. Yeah.
Absolutely. I born and raised.
In it for the long haul.
Right.
It's good. Okay, well, since you're active in the field right now of mental health, can you just talk about like what's happening right now?
Yeah, absolutely. Lots of things happening. We are absolutely seeing an increase in concerns around mental health issues with this pandemic. And there's a lot of factors that lead to that. Things like businesses aren't able to function like they normally can. It creates a sense of almost panic among folks and fear about will they be able to get their medications? Will they be able to leave the house to get their groceries? Will they be able to find the groceries they need? Are they healthy enough to be able to sustain should they get sick? So a lot of things that create anxiety, depression around this. And we have mental health agencies still operating, even though businesses are shut down. Agencies are still operating around the state, whether they're public agencies like community mental health centers or private agencies. They are still open for business. They're doing a lot of telehealth. And so that is a good resource for if they are feeling like they need to get assistance around mental health. They can reach out to those agencies to determine how to access their services.
That's really good. That's wonderful that people can still get the help that they need. I know personally, I've done counseling sessions in the past via Skype, even before all this happened, and just having that, having access to that just makes a world of difference. So thank
you. Absolutely.
Okay. So as we face this social isolation and depression and fear and worry around COVID, what are some important things that we can keep in mind as individuals at home?
Yeah, so it's a really scary time. And everybody, I hear people talking about how they're feeling isolated and the depression and just afraid and scared for everything. And it's important first that everybody know that those feelings are very valid and that they are very common feelings, right? These are reactions that we're having to a traumatic event. And a pandemic is a traumatic event. There's a lot of unknown and that can drive that fear in us. So when we're faced with an event like this pandemic, it's important to remember that we can have these stress reactions. So I'm just going to take a second to talk about what some of those stress reactions look like, because it's important for us to recognize those in ourselves when we start having them, but also to recognize them in our kids, our neighbors, our friends, family, so that we can help them. So there are different kinds. Emotional reactions you can have, like anger, guilt, depression, anxiety, mood swings, feeling overwhelmed, and a lot of irritability. You can also have reactions that are cognitive in nature. So things like confusion, blaming others, or even blaming yourself, having trouble concentrating and remembering things, just overall worry about things and difficulty making decisions. You can also have reactions that are behavioral. So that would be things like maybe crying more easily, or shifting the other direction, and maybe you used to cry a lot and you're no longer experiencing that. You can have a change in sleeping and eating habits or increased conflict in relationships. And then you can also have spiritual reactions. Those are things like feeling distant with God, withdrawal from your church, sudden turn towards God, or a feeling of loss of meaning or purpose around questioning your own beliefs. And then last, you can have reactions that are physical. So headaches, fatigue, difficulty sleeping, muscle tension, things along those lines. So there are some things we can do to assist with all of those things, because that's so overwhelming to hear. I know, like, Oh my gosh.
That's a lot.
Yeah. And you think about, oh my gosh, any one day you may experience a handful of those things, and the next day you may be okay and not experience those. So that is very common. We expect to see that after a traumatic event like this and while it's happening. And we know that about 90% of the population actually experience these types of reactions after an event. And about 10% of our population need just a little bit of emotional support to get beyond that, maybe a referral to further assistance.
Mm-hmm.
So some of the things we can do, one of the most important ones, I think, is controlling our exposure to media. So turning off the TV, wherever you get your news. So if it's social media, newspaper, the TV, or some other means, if you just listen to, I don't know,
people. The radio.
Right, the radio. That's really important to be able to turn off. We need to be able to turn it off and shut it down, because the amount of information we're getting is absolutely overwhelming right now. I feel like I'm in overload a lot of days with the information coming at me. So we can do that. We can also remember that social distancing is really physical distancing. We need to remember that we can still be social with folks. It's just, we have to kind of think outside the box with how to do that.
Yeah.
Like we're doing right here.
Yeah.
We've started FaceTiming with our kids and our family members more. It's been kind of fun, because we usually, you know, you just talk on the phone typically, or you pop in, but this has been a unique experience for us to be able to FaceTime. And so doing things on our iPads or iPhones, but also Skype and Zoom, WebEx, there's different functions out there. And we even use FaceTime Messenger as an option.
Yeah.
Have a cousin in Kenya who we can't really use the iPhone with. So we use the FaceTime Messenger and do a big group. Worked really well as well. So I think it's important for people to remember to be connected during this, being social still, making sure you're reaching out and touching base with others, and that will help. excuse me. A couple other things you can do during this time. It's really important to stick to a daily routine, and that's really difficult right now.
Yes.
Days I do really good at this, and some days it's a little bit harder for me to do. I also try to set goals for myself every day and making sure they're achievable. So if I have things I need to accomplish, whether it's work or personal, I try to make me some sort of list. I'm a list person. But making
me too.
Yeah. I mean, it's fun to check them off and cross them off when you've done it. I don't know. But making that you set achievable goals to try and get through the day, and then focusing on those positive aspects. So remembering the positive side of things right now, because there's a lot of things we can't control. And so we need to make sure that we are thinking around the things we can control.
Yeah.
And some days that's easier than others as well. And then taking time to relax and really relax, you know, trying to shut down. So doing activities that are stress reducing for you, things you enjoy, is going to be important. And then, of course, there's resources out there that if you are feeling overwhelmed that are important to know about. So one of my favorite resources, it's a federal resource, is the Disaster Distress Helpline. And it's operated 24/7. And you can call it or text it. So if you call it, I think the number is 1-800-985-5990. Or you can text, you actually text the words "talk with us" to 66746, and you can talk to a live person either via text or phone. And it's just a great resource to help during this time, especially if you're feeling overwhelmed and not sure what to do.
Oh, wow. And we can definitely link all of that below the video so people can just easily access that. That's so good that you can actually, that you can text, because I think, you know, it's a little intimidating to actually have a face-to-face or even a voice-to-voice, but texting is just so much, especially for people my age and younger.
Right. Absolutely.
So cool. Okay. So talking about parents, I'm a parent. I know we have a lot of parents that are going to be watching this video who are trying to either work at home and homeschool their kid, or even just being at home and homeschooling their kid if they're not even trying to work. It's very overwhelming. And I think a lot of us want to be perfect at it and want to do everything, all the things perfectly. And so what do you have to say about that?
Well, one, no, it's never going to be perfect. So children are unique. They can respond to stress in very different ways. And we need to understand that first and foremost as we try to parent at home and try to do school at home. It's double duty that we don't typically have to do. So understanding that kids are going to be anxious, they may be angry, they may be more clingy than they have been. They also may regress in their behaviors during this time. So thinking about things that they used to do and that they have kind of gotten over that hump on. So I'm thinking specifically about like bedwetting or sucking a thumb, and they may regress to some of those behaviors. Of course, there's others as well, but those two always stand out to me. Children also have had a huge change in their daily routine, right? They've suffered losses, and they're coming to realize that they have suffered these losses. And what may seem like not a big deal to us is an extremely huge deal to them. And so we need to understand that whether it's a fifth grade promotion or a field trip or a band concert or school dance or graduation, or even just realizing they're not going to get to see their friends and teachers before the end of the school year. You know, it's really important for us to understand that and know that they're going through a change just like we are. And so we have to be extra supportive. We need to set time to listen to them, to show them that we are here for them. So that extra attention and love is really important for them. So I encourage parents just to remember that. And remember all those things we just talked about a minute ago, because I think they pertain as well to the kids with the types of reactions they can have. And making sure that when we're taking the day and we're scheduling our routine, that it's not just about studying and doing work, that we're also setting aside time for playtime and relaxing. And that's going to be extremely important for the kids. And then just remember that there's no script for this. Right? There's none of us have done this before. These are unprecedented times, and we have to try to figure out what works. And what works for one of our kids may not work for the other. And what works for us one day may not work the next day. I know I have staff that have told me that it's been a real struggle trying to do this at home, because one day everything's fine, and then the next day meltdowns, and we just don't know what to do. So, I really want folks to just think about how to set that modeling behavior in that routine. And I think the kids will hopefully follow suit.
Modeling behavior. What, can you explain that a little bit more?
Yeah, absolutely. So with that daily routine, if it's that you're working at home and you're trying to get work done, what's going to work best? So is it best that you set up your workstation and your child has a workstation near you, because if it's comforting to them to feel like they're close to you in this uncertain time, and they see you working, and so then they want to work as well. They want to do what mom or dad are doing. And so modeling that type of behavior will hopefully help the kids shift their focus a little bit. The other thing I want to remind everyone, and I say this all the time, is that we have so many people working at home that supervisors also need to remember that parents are doing this double duty. And they need to be patient, and they need to have some understanding around that. Some days you may not be able to get as much work done as other days. And that's just life right now, and maybe for a while. So it's important for employees or employers to understand that employees may be struggling with this too. And just to be as good as possible.
That's a really good point. And that makes me breathe a little bit easier too. Yeah. Okay. So last question. What are some practical things we can do to take care of ourselves, take care of our children, even our neighbors, family?
Yeah. So this is probably one of my most favorite things to talk about. Self-care is extremely important. So first, taking care of others. We can't take care of others if we are not taking care of ourselves, first and foremost. You always hear that that metaphor about you can't pour from an empty cup, and that's absolutely right. You can't. So you have to figure out what fills your cup up and do that every day. And that should be something that recharges you and helps you just feel better about yourself and sustain you. So doing things that make you happy. So exercising, journaling, gardening, yoga, meditation, walking the dog, breathing exercises, whatever it is that makes you happy and fills you up is what we need to be setting aside time to do, to take care of ourselves. A lot of people feel like self-care is selfish because they have so many other people to take care of. But it's like that, you know, if you've ever flown, they talk about the face mask when it drops down. If you have to put yours on before anyone else's, and that's absolutely true, because if you can't breathe, you can't put it on anyone else, right? And you can't help the person next to you. And it's the same way with self-care. So if you aren't taking care of yourself, you're not going to be able to help your kids, your family, your neighbors. And I think that it's just really important that we are doing everything we can to make time for ourselves, even if it's 30 minutes before bed, that you say, okay, tonight I'm going to take 30 minutes and lay in bed and read, or on the couch or whatever that is, to just kind of recharge and let your mind take over for a minute to something besides COVID and to something besides every stressor that we are feeling throughout the day. And I know that that can be really difficult. I find that when I don't do it, I can really tell it the next day. And I've really tried to make that a part of my daily routine so that I can continue to take care of everyone and do the job I need to do right now as well. Mm-hmm. The other thing I would say is, once you've taken care of yourself, you know, if you have the ability to help others, I think that's wonderful. Reaching out, whether that's going out in your driveway and seeing your neighbor next door and just checking on them that way, or emailing or FaceTiming or a phone call or even a drive-by. I've had friends that have driven by my house and kind of waved, and even some that have stopped in the driveway and checked on us or left things on our front porch. That is amazing, and it goes a long way. There's folks out there that right now can't get out to get groceries because it's just not real safe for them to do so because of health or other reasons. So, you know, if we can drop groceries off to them or check in on them, it's going to be really important. And I think that's just really is going to help our stress level overall for all of us if we can do that.
Yes, such great advice. And I know that through the church, we have a sign-up form if anybody wants to sign up to help deliver groceries or prescriptions or even go shopping for somebody, that you can have the opportunity to do that. And I can link that below the video. So Beckie, thank you so much for joining us this morning and for speaking about all of these. I know that like it's been super encouraging to me to hear what you have to say. And I hope I'm sure it'll be the same for everybody who watches. So thank you so much for your time.
Welcome. Thank you.
Yeah. Have a great day.
You too.
Thanks.